evening, Process Optimizers, and welcome back to Salona Stellosphere. My name is Savannah Peterson, recording in Munich, Germany, alongside Ron Spetrick and our favorite analyst to have on the show, as someone who's been in this process mining and business optimization space for a long time. George, thanks for coming to join us this evening.
My pleasure. Always fun to join.
Yeah. So when you sat down, and I just want to capture on your excitement, the first thing you said was, I've learned so much. So give us an overview, some of the highlights of what you picked up over the last 2 days being here.
All right. So if I had to distill it down to one line, I'd say, like I was telling you guys earlier, this feels like when SAP was taking off in the U.S. in the early 90s. There, the dream was we are going to standardize wall to wall, you know, on one application so you can see everything that's going on in the enterprise. We all know that didn't happen. And actually, really, it was just a continuation of 60 years of building islands of automation and analytic data silos. Now, the Salona's value proposition is that we can build a single source of truth across these islands of automation and data, and then create a map of the business as it's currently running, and then analyze how to transform that into a more ideal state. That is a very high value, you know, business proposition. And it's very different from 50 years of packaged software where you force fit a business, a departmental function into how the package runs. This is very different. And there's one other high level takeaway. So everyone in the entire tech industry and beyond knows that there's been this stampede into AI. And, you know, we've funded tens of billions of dollars between VCs and big tech, bordering, you know, closing in on hundreds of billions with the data center development. And I've got a sort of a man-bites-dog moment, which is that the real value isn't in these frontier models or even the specialized models. It's in this harmonized source of truth that tells you how the business is running. The agents are like the little machine tools, and then the source of truth is like your digital factory, and this is much more valuable. And there's only a few companies doing this, and Salonis is emerging. And so I think you're going to see a lot of focus on Salonis in the years going forward.
Yeah, I think one of the things, just picking up off of what you said, was, again, because we talk about this a lot, is that there are not just there's silos of AI going on.
Yeah.
There's silos of the data underneath AI. And I think Salonis' message about being able to go across that, I don't care if it's in Databricks, in Snowflake, in SAP, in Salesforce, you know, CRM, or even in supply chain management, in your, you know, PMM software layer, they'll bring it all in to be able to harmonize that. I think one of the things is how much of it goes in and how much of it stays out and, you know, what is needed. There's some optimizations to be there, but the big thing, I think, to what you were getting at is they know the process of what the agent needs to do.
Yeah.
And I think, to me, that was always missing when we're having these agent conversations.
Because the agents that most companies are shipping are reinforcing those islands of automation, islands of analytics. They're not changing that. And so, basically, you know, there's the biblical Tower of Babel, and Salonis is like demolishing that and turning it into a parking lot, you know, so that it's just all harmonized. And so where we had ERP, CRM, HCM, procurement, supply chain, they're putting a layer over that, the end-to-end process map. And they're doing something else, too. For 60 years, we've been dealing with data at the level of strings, like bits and bytes. They're up-leveling it to things. We've talked about this on theCUBE before. But what you don't really, you can't see it until you go look into their tools. To up-level strings to things, you really are changing the focus from rows and columns and tables in a SQL database to essentially a graph that deals with processes over time. And there are precious few application or tool vendors out there that have that whole platform and the application building environment on top of it. And so I'm talking tech level stuff right now, but
I think you're doing a great job, actually, though, of summarizing the ecosystem and the advantage of the ecosystem that they were talking about. Process Intelligent Graph is obviously very core to that. But to your point, I just have to point out, you are absolutely smashing the analogy game from stampede to harmonizing things to
parking lot.
I know, so you're really covering all the bases here. But the way that I've thought about it a lot with a background in supply chain is, in the old days, supply chain was like a game of telephone. One person takes a phone, says something to the other guy, here, I'm passing this thing along, here you go. And if something's been done improperly or if there's a risk somewhere down the chain, it ends up actually having quite a waterfall effect moving down the line, and that can impact productivity, margin, profit, a whole bunch of things, morale. I mean, there's a lot of different layers there. And what's really interesting about Celonis and what I've been picking up here, to your point, is not only are they eliminating that game of telephone, they're harmonizing it like a choir, but now the choir or everyone participating in that harmony is all speaking the same language. And that is a big difference. No matter the legacy systems they have, we can all understand the same thing, and that can roll up to the decision makers who are calling the shots.
You hit the core thing, which is all these agents and all the AI, they're based on large language models, but every application speaks its own language. And until you have a common language across them, you can't have agents working to communicate and give you visibility. So, in other words, not just within your own company, but upstream and downstream, like to your customers, up to your suppliers, where you can say, you know, I might have a bottleneck or a kink in my process here. How is that going to ripple, you know, ripple downstream or ripple upstream? And so you're seeing essentially the mapping of processes over greater and greater scope. And since everything is connected by data, you basically now have this data-driven control plane. Management gets embodied in software, and the scope and fidelity of your management product, because management now is not just know-how, it's increasingly embedded in a product. The scope and fidelity of your management system is a software product that is limited only by how far you've harmonized in a single language.
Exactly. And that's when we start to see the real value. And speaking of value, I think one of the things that's also struck me a lot about this week has been the time to value. Every single one of the wonderful customers that we've had the opportunity from NHS to BMW they were talking about Pfizer achieving over $300 million of value out of the last 3 years. And doing this quickly, they're getting agents off the ground in 7 weeks. They're seeing impact in 60 days across the organization. That's an order of magnitude, if not two, faster than we've seen with other historic transformations in the digital space, which is why it's so much easier for folks to make the decision to start applying Celonis' toolkit to their ecosystem and expanding that.
You hit on another key point, which is traditional software was like, you put a packaged application in, and then you force fit, like with a bulldozer, your business to match the existing processes and data structures in that application. Here, you take all your existing applications and analytic data, and then you mine it to map into whatever structures you want to work on first. And so it goes in much faster.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about this with the fact that, you know, when you're doing the ETL and you're looking at the models and the modeling and stuff of that nature, it's got to be critical to how that process works. And, you know, hey, revenue, it needs to be the same here as it is over there, is over here, between these different processes. What I'm seeing is that they have a very metered way of going out so that you're expanding the model as you go versus, hey, I'm going to force you into a model and tell you how it is. Now, they have best practices and other things around different industries, but it wasn't like that. And to your point on the data stuff, it's, hey, we can take data how you can give it to us. I think what was really interesting was, and I think, you know, BMW talked about it, was the fact that, you know, getting up and running, one of the key keys to them was flexibility, mm-hmm. because they had a data lake prior to being with Celonis.
Yeah.
So they could connect it up pretty easily. Do you see that as one of the keys as well, is that flexibility?
It's funny. It's like I've got to give you guys, you know, like a dollar for each time you say something because you're teeing up something I wanted to get to. One of the big changes, going back to the theme of 50 years of tables and rows and columns, bits and bytes, the process intelligence graph is basically a way of saying people, places, things, and activities in the real world, but it has implications because, let's say, if you want to build an app that works with SAP data, you have to navigate 50,000 tables with three-letter German acronyms, whereas in the process intelligence graph, then a citizen developer can take essentially from a visual gallery, you know, these elements and build what's not just a dashboard, but it can have action buttons that then operationalize the decisions that push back into SAP or PeopleSoft or Oracle or whatever. It's a profound change because we've been dealing with analytic artifacts like just view-only dashboards. Now people build these little applications that do stuff like reprioritize orders or unblock, you know, orders that have been held up for credit. It's a complete change because now app development moves that into the business.
I think that's a really good point. I mean, we were having that conversation with Patrick just a few minutes ago. At BMW, 30 different plants across the world, everything from optimizing the folks who design the paint for the vehicles to the manufacturing line to how they're rolling things out to the customer and benefiting them at the end game. These are very different challenges, and yet Celonis' toolkit can come in and help tie them all together. It's a really interesting bundle. George, I'm curious, since you've had a different vantage point than Rob and I have had here sitting on the desk, what are some of the use cases and examples that you've seen or conversations you've had that really struck you the last few days?
Well, the biggest thing is when you up-level from strings to things, you move application development, just as you're describing, out into the people, the domain experts. Today, you build applications or you team it up with people who are data engineers, like data analysts. You have a whole lot of technical folks, and it's bottlenecked on a sort of central application development function and a data engineering function. That's the bottleneck. But when essentially that is leveled up so that it's, you know, real-world stuff, then you're not bottlenecked, and you basically now have an application development toolkit. It's almost like when we took spreadsheets and allowed people to build financial models without going to, you know, some central IT group that only had a few people able to do it. Then financial modeling became something everyone could do. And the key is, it's that process intelligence graph and the knowledge layer that you put on it now essentially empowers everyone else to build apps.
Absolutely. One other thing you mentioned, real-world applications. One of the most real-world things that we see all across the show floor is the emphasis on sustainability.
Yes.
Sustainability within business, sustainability within AI, but most importantly, sustainability for our planet. The Earth's our future is one of their core values at Celonis. How does the language around that and the conversation around that this week compare to other events and areas that you personally cover?
That's actually interesting. I think partly that it's in Europe where they're more...
That's a great observation.
You know, they're more conscious about that. You know, we, and I include myself, we Americans often drive big, gas-guzzling SUVs, and I'm told this has to be my last one, you know, so I'm going to hang on to it for a while. And in Europe, you know, they don't use dryers, not just they're poor and don't have them,
right?
But because they save energy. But so yes, they are. So when you build these applications, you have essentially a tree of metrics that measures how your business runs, and you can set these as dials. As you know, these are my constraints. It's like in a power plant, all the dials. And a critical one here is, you know, like carbon footprint.
Yeah.
So we are more conscious of it here than back on the stage.
And I mean, just adding on to that, and you know, kind of my thought on that was having an off-camera discussion about it was the fact that there are also data points that third-party data flows that can be flowed into the process to then help. And we had that discussion around how you can use some of the ranking of companies, and that can be put into your process about their sustainability rankings when you're actually building your supply chain, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
And you can do that in an automated way.
Yes. So it's not just on-time performance, but it's, you know, it's carbon footprint. And then you can rank, you know, you can make those decisions automated. All those are just descriptive attributes, you know, of resources that you're optimizing.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. Yanina and Peter, who we interviewed this afternoon, both brought up different but complementary aspects of that puzzle. I do think you're right that it's about Europe. I think that AI and ESG is a hot conversation around the world right now. But yes, to your point, they're much more energy conscious here. I think they're a bit more fashion conscious to our earlier point, which is kind of which is a lot of fun. And even, you know, I enjoy that Yanina pointed out that the venue that we're in here actually has a real goal towards sustainability, and they were willing to partner with Celonis to say, hey, this is our impact, and allow them to calculate the true impact of an event like this. I can say personally, I'm very grateful that I took the train from Amsterdam instead of taking a plane on this particular trip, because I realized the train ride, I believe, over there versus the plane ride just from Paris to Munich, 10x the carbon impact if you're in an aircraft versus on a train. I wish the United States would also take a note out of their public transportation book and give us some more high-speed rail in the United States.
We are. Quick digression, in the U.S. going to feel our disregard for sustainability goals in property insurance, you know. That
I think we already are.
Yeah.
Lots of Californians can't get insured right now, as we know, and same thing in hurricane country and everywhere else.
One last thing I want to mention
about
the big change is, as we go from this traditional application model that was primarily seat-based pricing, you know, even though we went from perpetual to subscription, it was often the center of gravity was seat-based, and this consumption pricing on the data platforms. Now we're going to shift to something much closer to value-based pricing, where you're getting closer to the economic outcome of the customer. You know, that's a profound change. And that's it's as you move from infrastructure focus to real-world things focus, you're getting closer to the impact that you're going to have on the customer. Ultimately, you're going to get embedded in their cost of goods sold to some extent and in their operating expenses.
I think that's a really excellent point, like everything else you said. Last question for you, gentlemen. We've learned a lot the last few days. We've heard some really interesting stories. We have one more very full day left tomorrow. What are you most excited about in the next 24 hours? George, I'll start with you.
Most excited in the next one. I want to see more about the development tools that they're building, because everything we've seen in the data platform space, it's a very rich ecosystem, but it's still plumbing. It assumes the plumbing is tables and rows and columns, and you know so the tooling here is less mature. But it is so much higher level and richer. Yeah, I want to explore that.
I think that's a great call. What about you, Rob?
Yeah, I think I want to continue to kind of poke at how things come together and how it actually from the cost and how you're paying for it, and how we talked to some of the customers about how they saw ROI because they were able to reduce a lot outside of the infrastructure. So that has to have a multiplier effect, which is, I love unpacking that to understand, okay, this is the multiplier effect. You're paying for this. You may have a little more double data, but this is why you're doing it, because you're saving over here.
I'm also curious about that. Frankly, just speaking quite literally, I'm very curious to see who wins their first ever hackathon tomorrow afternoon. Yanina was telling us The teams had 5 hours yesterday, or yeah, I believe it was yesterday, and they actually achieved MVP working solutions in just that short amount of time. So I can't wait to learn about the finalists. I can't wait to see who wins. And I can't wait to continue to bring all of you, wherever you might be on this beautiful rock, our power-packed coverage at Solana's Cellosphere in Munich, Germany. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.